Does it run? Yes, it runs.
Okay, hello everybody. I couldn't make it to the lecture. I'm right now in Barcelona, as you're seeing this. So I will do a lecture on my own in my house at the kitchen table. And Gulnar asked me to talk a bit about how I work with image in my work. And I must say, I did not really put a lot of effort in that ever in my career as an artist. But if somebody asks you a question like that, then you start to think about it. And then I found out that it does play a big role in my work, but not, let's say, in an aesthetic way. I would like to start with this book, Aesthetics in the Wild, to explain very briefly what I do. It's written by Michel van Dartel, and actually Michel is doing a statement that, let's say, the arts should be, or should, could be more in the wild, let's say, working into the context of the real world instead of the isolated world of the museum. And he states that, let's say, in the science, this is already happening since the 80s, while in the art world, it's still, let's say, in the phase that things should be in a laboratory and should be isolated to come to the purity of a good artwork. Well, in science, this happened. This is also a nice picture because it's very simple, but it explains a very complex idea. Here you see a picture where actually artificial intelligence was for the first time noticed that objects can be way more intelligent if they are working in feedback with their environment. And that's proven by this little experiment, because here you see a little car with two wheels on the back, and every wheel has an engine, and every engine is attached to a sensor in front of the car. And the engine shuts down if it gets dark, and the engine goes on when there's light. So it's a very simple system. Then what happened is that this engine was connected to this sensor. Basically, the car was always crashing into walls because it would turn away from the light. And then what they did is they did a very simple change, is that the left sensor was attached to the right engine. And suddenly the machine could always drive to the light and never bounce into any object anymore. So this little machine, which you could not even call a brain, could behave in a very intelligent way. And that sort of proved for a scientist that if you want to create a complex thing like artificial intelligence, you should not try to isolate all options which are possible, like, let's say, all the possibilities to drive, go left, go right. You don't have to program that into a machine. You can also give the machine some sensors and some simple tools, and then it can start behaving in its own way. Well, if you look at, let's say, arts, that you could you know, state the same, because humans are also intelligent if they are in context. If you put somebody isolated in a room, then people go nuts. But if you put people in a group, then they can do very intelligent things. So if you look at the arts, then what would happen, let's say, if you work as an artist into the context of the real world? What can then an artwork do? Then it can actually start to communicate on many levels, which would make the artwork more rich and more intelligent. Well, anyway, it's a great simple book. I suggest everybody reads it. And I was very happy with this because basically that's what I try to do now for a long time in my career as an artist. So the image has a very, let's say, secondary role in my work, and at the same time I use it a lot. Let me show you some of my stuff. I have to walk around with the camera. So I feel actually quite hip now as a vlogger. Okay, so these are some of my works. Not sure if you can see it, but I'll also send you the images. Basically, this is 15 years of work, and every picture
resembles a project which I did. And most projects of me are long-term projects, so they last sometimes for years. So it's a long process. And if you then have to summarize a project, then it somehow always comes back to one simple picture, which I then hope explains the whole story. Well, but let me give you, for example, this project. This is the picture I use of the Snelweg Safari. This is well, as I said, is that image is always a secondary part in my work. And that is because I always start with a location. So I always go somewhere, get inspired by a place, and then from there a project emerges. So I never know basically what kind of image comes out of it, because I also don't know what I'm gonna do. So here you see some images of projects I did over the last 10 years. And it's quite pathetic to think that in two pages you actually can fit 15 years of work. And every image sort of resembles a research on a specific location. And although you sometimes make like hundreds of pictures or even thousands of pictures, there's always one picture that lasts and which sort of makes it easy to talk about the project. Well, I can show also some projects which never came into this pictures, because those projects also disappear out of my story. This is a good example. I was, I think in 2010, I did this project about actually not an image. So I became blind in several occasions, and it was always for a full day. And then I tried to, experience the city or a location without sight. So I was blindfolded, and then I went with another real blind person into the city. And this drawing is about the Afrikaanderwijk, where we went. That's a neighborhood here in Rotterdam. And there's a big market, and we went there together for a full day to try to basically get there and go to the market and then try to get back home, which sort of took us a full day. And I tried after that to put that into an image. That's what you see here. So this is like a storyboard, or you could also call it, which they use in the music. So you have the lines, and then the little drawings are basically only the words or the sounds I heard. So on the end, it's a bit of a clumsy image, because it becomes more like an infographic than a real image. And that's also why I never talk about this project anymore, because basically there's nothing to see. Another issue I have is, and that's maybe good to tell about this project, is the fact that if you go into context, if you go into a new situation, then you don't want to have a camera always in front of your face if you talk to new people. Because if there's a camera, then people start to act differently, and there's a huge distance between you and, let's say, the place you're researching. So I always sort of, try to keep the camera as far as possible and start to make pictures in a later stage. But that also means that on the spot, you never have a good image of the situation where you're in, or the story where you're in. So, for example, in this project, I was doing an experiment with Bram Esser. We lived in my car for a full month on the Dutch highways. And we tried to, we asked ourselves the question, can you live on the highway? Can you live in a car, and can you survive? And what happens if you do that? So for a full month, we were together in this car trying to survive. And Bram was writing and I was taking pictures. But at the same time, everywhere we went, we also wanted to be be you know, not too exposed or expose people instantly by what they were doing. So we want to keep it as natural as possible. So let's say the documentation I came back with after a full month was very clumsy. I mean, I was taking pictures with my phone. I was having a camera, but was only taking the picture when people were not in sight. So basically, the documentation was so bad that I could hardly work from it. So for example, we were interviewing this guy who we met on the street, and then I didn't dare to take a picture of him because then the interview would never have took place. So having a very bad documentation, then on the end we wanted to make this book. And then what do you do if your images suck? So basically, from there I started to make drawings instead of using the pictures. And then you sort of find out that you can do great things with drawings. Eh? For example, this drawing is, we were eating highway food for a full month. So it's basically meat, salt and fat. And then you get this disease which people have, we call it scheurbuik, I don't know the English word, where your teeth almost fall out and you get really fat at the same time. And so, people on sea in the old days would get this disease, that your teeth fall out because you don't get vitamins. The only difference is that in that time people didn't get fat, but nowadays you do. But anyway, that's nice, because you can put it easily into a drawing. Well, then let's say I was also thinking about, because this is an example of my clumsiness and how do you deal with clumsiness, but at the same time I did made one picture in these 15 years which was relatively successful as an image. That's this picture. It's a project I did at the Waddenzee. It's a sea in the north of Holland. And I built this gas station in the middle of the sea. And every day the flood would come. And then it would, you know, sort of, get flooded. And then when the tide comes, it goes down. So that was the project. But then during the process of basically fighting with the elements to keep this structure up, I took a lot of pictures, and one day there was this moment that the sun broke through and the water was just coming up, and then, well, let's say the light was almost perfect, and I took this picture. And I think over the years I sold this picture more than 40 times to different places, from galleries to books to magazines. And let's say aesthetically, this is obviously a very seductive picture, but at the same time it's also a very boring picture because it's basically blue, yellow and red. But it follows, let's say, the biological aesthetics of how we as people see an image. So it's powerful, and at the same time, for me, this project didn't do much in terms of being in context or in relation to a location. But at the same time, you could say the picture gives a nice contrast between a sea and a human element. Well, then last but not least, I thought what is also interesting is that, you know, let's say the most successful projects are also the ones who somehow become iconic. And I think this is one of my best examples of how a project sort of goes viral. This is the turtle one. That's the car I built together with a local community in Ghana in 2013. And I think we took thousands of pictures, not only me, but a whole group of journalists, photographers, video people. And from all these pictures, this picture became the icon of the project. And basically, this is not a scripted picture. This is something which happened on the spot, because we were trying to make a good photo of the car, because every time we tried that, there were always people running around or wanted to be on the picture. And so it was very hard to make a sort of aesthetic photo. So we went to the harbor, where there were not too many people, or know people. And we started to photograph the car. But then halfway, more and more people walked by, wanted to know what we were doing. And we were basically having a hard time to keep the people out of the picture. And at the same time, so we tried to keep, let's say, the car clean. And then we were finished with the photo shoot. And then we said, okay, let's do a picture all together. And then in a second, everybody jumped on the car. We took the picture and thought, okay, that's just nice for the moment. And then while we started to edit the footage, then somehow this last picture popped up. And we thought, well, actually, this is the most interesting one. So let's say this was a lucky shot and sort of grew out into the icon of this project. Well, so I hope this gives a sort of idea of how the image can be useful. At least I learned something from it. So thank you for asking me this question. And I hope you all have a great evening. And I'm looking forward to hear where the discussion was about. Bye-bye.